Well, Will first said about he grew up in a certain place, so he had an affinity to an area. And I guess for myself, it was the same thing growing up in New York City, where you get a certain affinity that you know best about. One of the first photo influences I had was one of the newspapers. They had a Sunday column called New York's Changing Scene, where what it was is they had a street corner at random, how it looked maybe 25, 50, 100 years ago, and from the same angle, what it looks like now. So looking at the new ones, I knew a lot of those places, exactly where it was shot. So when Will said about having an affinity with the area and knowing it, it was exactly the same situation with me, except not instead of a small town, we're talking about 30-story square buildings. But that was my first influences. Because of it, most of my New York work was the influence. I know Ansel Adams, Edward Weston, and the whole California school were very good. They were very good craftsmen. I know that for a fact because too many people wrote and said they were. But but I never, to me they just looked like pretty pictures from a place that I've never been. So the Ansel thing never turned me on. Because of that, where I got lucky was a lot of the well-known photographers at that time. Eventually, I got to meet when I was real young, and their influences were incredible about how they saw the city, what they thought of the city, how to deal with people on the city. Probably my earliest influence was Ouija. And Ouija, in a lot of levels, I could relate to him real good. I loved the guy, but I also studied his work and everything about him, and how lucky and blessed I was, because later on he trusted me enough to give me negatives to print. But Ouija also, I studied everything at the time that Ouija wrote, and one of the books he wrote that started off, when people asked me, how do I take these pictures, his comment was, if it looks like a good picture, I do it. although Ouija himself was known as a murder, crime, photographer thing, he was also working for a newspaper, which means whether it's a good day or a bad day, they gotta have pictures to fill the page. So when nothing is happening, he had a backlog about human interest stuff dealing itself with New York City. People, places, things, local characters. So he was probably my biggest influence. As a kid, I was totally eager, looking to conquer the whole world with the camera. And I don't know when I stopped. I don't know when I stopped, but I still carried the camera around. And to quote Ouija, if something looked like a good picture, I snapped it. So I always had a camera with me at the time. So that's that was basically my background. Art training, I was at an art school, a vocational art school. They did forgive me for how bad a drawing I did, but I was in the photo department, so that was the excuse. We would go to museum classes, and we'd go through all the art things, the Renaissance and the Surrealists and the Impressionists, and I'm just boring. And then they went into a room that they called the New York Ashcan School. Yeah, I don't know if anybody's familiar with the artists of the Ashcan School, but there were guys. Edward Hopper wasn't. He was on the periphery. But there was a lot of other people, and maybe it might help if you see some of their work on the internet. They weren't photographers, but some of the artists like Glackens, Reginald Marsh, wow, I wish I could photograph like those guys painted. That's the way I wanted to take pictures. Of course, I found out later, especially with Reginald Marsh, and again, you got to see his work to know what I'm talking about. He would go to Coney Island, shoot dozens of photos, bring them back to his studio, lay them out, and then make a collage of hundreds of people on in all different poses and beaches at Coney Island and other places, the Bowery. So, but that was basically where my first influences were. Maybe the two biggest patches of green, three big patches of green that we ever saw growing up as a kid. We had a Central Park, Bronx Park, which is a big zoo, and the other big patch of green was the pool table. And, very rare did I go to the country. I found a friend who was just as crazy as I was, and we'd go on long trips together to different places. There was only one problem. I was at the time a habitual chain smoker, and he did not allow cigarettes in the car. What do I do with my hand? You know, I got to do something. I've got to light it. So I started fumbling with the camera and started snapping pictures out the window. And that was, I forget, late 60s, maybe early 70s. Been doing it ever since. Actually, that's what I did all the way out here until the light went bad. But coming to this town was definitely culture shock. It's been described as ghost town, abandoned village. But at one time it was a very thriving community for the size of it. And around here, that's what I try shooting pictures of, what used to be and how nature is reclaiming it. You gotta be there at the right light, at the right time. If you see good pictures, take a picture of it, but come back a little bit later, the light will be different. And come back a little bit later, the light will be different again. If you're dealing with digital, you don't have to worry about the cost of film. If you're dealing with film, maybe you got to be a little bit more selective, and instead of having 30 different variations of lighting, you only should do 10 variations. But no matter how many variations of a certain lighting you do, If it's 50, one will be better than the other 49. You have a lot of time to look, to think. It's not the kind of situation where you're like taking pictures of sports where you got to have quick reflex, because the action's the greatest. The good picture is no more than a thousandth or 20,000th of a second. You just got a lot of time to think, compose, look around for the best angle. And if you take a picture of something nice in the background, if you don't look for a foreground, your nice background picture will be like everybody else's. If you see something nice in the foreground and you don't have a nice background, it'll be like everybody else's. And if you do that, why do they want to look at your work? You look like everybody else's. So that's the thing to try to avoid. Technique is important. You got to be reasonably sharp. You got to be reasonably focused. The right exposure. But that rule applies to thousands of people. What do you got to do with your work, with your camera, with this situation, this technique, to make it look different than anybody else's? Make lots of alternatives and wish you well in making the decision. I don't have a website, but one of the girls in school took pity on me and gave me a Christmas present of a Facebook. And there's a lot of me on Google, so my work is around. Somebody told me there's lots of things on Yahoo that's not on Google, but I don't own a computer and don't know how to use one, so I never saw it. Speaking of computers and digital photography, in 82, I was in England, and they have a magazine called the British Journal of Photography. At that particular time, I was reading it, and they had an article about this new technique called digital. The first digital camera just came out on the market. They gave a review, and it was very, very British review, where they really went into how terrible it was. They spoke about things like resolution, they spoke about highlights, they spoke about shadow detail, and all the things that were bad about it, terrible about it. And the final sentence in the article was, however, we do have a new technique, a new technology in making photos we never had before, and it will continue to refine itself. You know, the shutter goes from maybe 1 second to, I don't know, 1,000th, 10,000th of a second. F-stops are very wide open to stopped all the way down. F-stop controls depth of field. Shutters control motion. If you're going to go with the lowest F-stop, maybe everything from this chair, something 3 inches away, all the way to infinity, is sharp. If you open the f-stop all the way, you'll just get something in the front isolated, and the rest of the background will be out of focus like a seamless paper. The shutter speed's the same thing. Use a slow shutter for motion, like waterfall, water running, or the highest shutter speed to make the trickling water look like an icicle. So that would be a way of starting to try to do it. For the film people, if you expose normally, develop normally, you will get a beautifully nice looking print that will look like everybody else's. If you're in a situation where you overexpose a little bit more excessively, and then try to make a good print of it, you'll get a whole different look than if it was a normal thing. A little elaboration. If you're in the darkroom normally, you according to the rule, 10 seconds exposure, number 2 grade, you might have to do a 50 second exposure on a number 4 grade. But it would look different. And the trick is, you don't put it in your face. You just let the audience know there's something different about it, but I don't know what it is. Yeah, you don't, because if you go too much, then it's more than the material was made to begin with. Another thing that I do, and as we were coming here, I guess everybody noticed I had this nice little 35 standard Nikon with a wide angle lens. I'm just popping pictures out the window. I think about it sometimes as like a drive-by shooting. Well, when we start pulling our toys out, the toy I'll be pulling out is slightly different than the one I was using yesterday. So varying the equipment, and again, we got a problem because you got to have a lot of money to have a lot of toys to play with. Where I've been lucky, the camera store that I deal with, the owner, lets me borrow a lot of toys from them. Which some of the toys I'm going to be using was borrowed from them. So that's some of the things I try to do to make it a little bit different. He asked me a question about how do you make your pictures look different than anybody else's. When I say like being different, for example, most cameras get film cameras, what you have is you start off with the normal as a 50 millimeter zoom. No, a 50 millimeter lens. Everybody uses it because, hey, that was the lens that came with the camera. So you have to vary the lenses. There are lots of variations. What the lenses are made for different purposes. 50 millimeter, quote unquote, is normal. Most of the time it is. And everybody uses it. It's the standard equipment. But maybe if you do the same picture, the exact same way, but back up with an extreme telephoto lens to do the same framing, all of a sudden, by doing the same picture with a lot of lenses that most people don't even know about, much less use, you've got a head start in making it look a little bit different than anybody else. The thing also, what I said before about make it lighter or darker. When you're controlling the picture between tonality and contrast and density, it's a little bit like making a soup. You know, you've got to put a little bit of salt in there, and maybe, you overdid it. Maybe I should water it down a little bit. The thing is, with the digital, your final product is a printout on what looked beautiful on the computer. And it looked beautiful on the computer because you were viewing it through transmitted rather than reflected light is what your printout is getting. I think I done talked myself out.
Thank you.
Good job.
You can sit down.
If there's any...